Welcome in Christ's name here to the benefice of Cassington and Ensham. My name is Roger Aston and I'm Associate Curate here in the benefice. Today is the second Sunday of Lent and I'll be leading us in a service of Holy Communion from the Book of Common Prayer. Our service today is actually from St. Peter's Church in Cassington. Our vicar, Duncan Fraser, will preach to us a little later on peace, following the sermon series that we're following on the fruits of the Spirit. Regarding Holy Communion, our liturgy reminds us that in Holy Communion, we receive Christ in our hearts by faith. So, although we cannot all share in the bread and the wine, I would encourage you, each of you, to open your hearts to receive Christ in faith, as I receive the bread and wine for us. Our service opens with a hymn of praise, "Great is thy faithfulness." We pray the Collect for Purity together. Almighty God, and to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. There are no other commandments greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee." And the collect for the Queen. Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and power infinite, have mercy upon the whole church, and so rule the heart of thy chosen servant, Elizabeth, our Queen and Governor, that she, knowing whose minister she is, may above all things seek thy honour and glory, and that we and all her subjects, duly considering whose authority she hath, may faithfully serve, honour and humbly obey her, in thee and for thee, according to thy blessed word and ordinance, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth, ever one God, world without end. Amen. And we remain in prayer for the collect for the day, the collect for the second Sunday of Lent. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion that they may reject those things which are contrary to their profession, and follow all such things that are agreeable to the same, through the Lord Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our epistle reading is taken from the letter to the Colossians, chapter 2, verses 12 to 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And the Holy Gospel is written in the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14 and verses 15 to 27. If you love me, you will obey what I command, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obeys them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, "But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus replied, "If anyone loves me, he will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and he will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord. Before Duncan comes to open God's word to us, let us declare our faith together in the words of the Creed. And after Duncan has preached, we will sing the hymn, "Dear Lord and Father of Mankind." But first, the Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who, for us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who, with the Father and the Son together, is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
It's great to be heading towards spring. And I know some of you will be itching to get back into the garden. So it's perfect time to be talking about the fruit of the Spirit in our current series of talks. You see, the analogy of Galatians 5 is that if you leave your life unattended, all sorts of things that you don't want there will naturally grow up. You know, back in Galatians 5, Paul talks about all sorts of things, including discord and jealousy and rage and selfish ambition, a whole list of things that, you know, in the moment sometimes just bubble up naturally, but in the end make us miserable. Just like a garden unattended grows weeds and nettles and eventually prevents any enjoyment of the garden at all. But as followers of Jesus, we're invited to choose to allow the Holy Spirit to cultivate our hearts and lives so that his fruit grows. You know, often involves counterintuitive choices that don't always seem natural at first, but will lead to these amazing qualities: love, joy, peace, kindness, faithfulness, and others springing up in our lives and taking root. I wonder, as we think over these weeks of the fruit of the Spirit, which aspect of the fruit is most dear to you, or perhaps at the moment most needed. And of course, that will depend on our personalities and perhaps our stage of life and what we're going through at the moment. But today we're talking about peace. And I think that is something that, with everything that we've been through in the last year, we need more than ever. Particularly when we consider that for those living in the Middle East, peace was shalom, that wonderful word that encompasses much more than that we think of when we use the word peace. Shalom communicates a sense of harmony, of wholeness and completeness, welfare and contentment. It's a beautiful idea, and it's a beautiful fruit of the life that is in step with the Holy Spirit. And we may well ask in this day, when we've been separated from loved ones and when we're anxious for our health and theirs and others and unable to properly grieve those we've lost, when we're worried about our livelihood in the economy of the nation and what impact lockdown is going to have on the future lives of children, where is shalom? But in some ways, our current experiences have just reminded us of what has always been true of us as the human race. In many ways, we're marked by restlessness and discontent, anxiety, and unconnectedness. Sometimes it's hidden beneath the surface or brushed aside with entertainment and noise and busyness. But when we take a moment to be still, those things will surface. If you're anything like me, that is why many of us struggle with silence. It asks too many questions of us. It unclothes us, exposes our peace deficiency. The scripture, as we know, puts its finger on the source of this soul discomfort right at the outset. You know, we were made for God, and a selfless connection with each other and creation, but we chose another path. And as we experience this exile from the garden, as it were, our longing for shalom is a longing for home. You know, Augustine puts it so well, doesn't he, in his prayer: "Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our heart is restless." There's the peace deficiency. "Our heart is restless until it finds its rest in thee." So the great story of God that we rehearse this Lent and Passiontide and Easter is that God, in his great love, visits us in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. He visits us in our place of exile, and he says to us from our reading, "Peace, shalom, I leave with you. My peace I give you." That sense of harmony, of oneness with God and with creation, that sense of contentment and completeness and fullness. "My peace," Jesus says. And he said it on the eve of his crucifixion, for it is at the cross when he wins for us this peace, when he ends our exile, when he opens the door that leads home. And through the door, almost before time, it rushes the Spirit of God and says to us, you know, you can know this peace now in the midst of the mess. Before God has sorted everything out, in the midst of all that you're going through, this non-shalomness around you, You can allow me, says the Spirit, to tend the garden of your heart so that peace might grow year upon year. But of course, the fruit of the Spirit is not just something that happens automatically. We are to cooperate with the Spirit. In the words of Galatians 5, we are to keep in step with the Spirit. And in our reading from Colossians, we have this verse I just want to highlight for us briefly to think about together. How do we keep in step with the peace-giving Spirit? The Apostle Paul says this, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace, and be thankful." So just four words from there that I just want to highlight for us today. And the first word is let. You know, like all aspects of following Jesus and becoming like Jesus, it's a choice to receive what Christ is doing through his Spirit. It's a choice to receive the peace of Christ, to let him do his work, to give the Spirit room in our lives and permission in our lives to grow his fruit. You know, it's that growing the fruit of the Spirit is passive in one sense because it doesn't come from us, it comes from the Spirit. But in another sense, we cooperate. That's why Paul says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. And sometimes that letting takes conscious effort. And that's partly what Lenten disciplines are all about, making space to ensure that God can do his business in our lives. You know, maybe we need to, and maybe you're doing this already, I just want to encourage you to keep going, just making space in your day for quietness and stillness before God. And in that moment, we can just say, Holy Spirit, come. We're conscious of the Holy Spirit. We're conscious that he is holy. In fact, he's very sensitive. He's easily grieved by our sin because he is so holy. And his work is quenched when we don't give him that room. But we step aside and we confess our sins and we open ourselves to him and say, give us this precious fruit, peace in our lives. And we receive it by faith for the day. And we do that every day, don't we? The second word I want us to think about is rule. You know, immediately we hear the word rule, our heckles are raised naturally when we think about giving over the rule of our hearts and our lives. It's one of the hardest things we do as followers of Jesus, but it is an integral part of our discipleship and of our receiving and giving room for peace to grow in our hearts. You know, it's interesting that in our reading, the promise of peace, the reading from the gospel, the promise of peace that Jesus gives us is preceded by his comment that says, you know, our love for him is authenticated by obeying his commandments, keeping his way. And in Colossians, it comes amidst a number of exhortations to certain kinds of behavior and practice in keeping with the likeness of Jesus. You know, peace comes when we abdicate the throne of our lives and give it to Jesus, when we give up control and acknowledge that we're not God and we allow him to be God in our lives. And it does seem challenging and counterintuitive for us to do that, but we can trust Jesus with our lives and relinquish the idea that we can find shalom on our own. Now, the peace of Christ can only rule in our hearts when we have given up ruling our hearts ourselves. Third word is body. Paul, of course, is referring to the church when he uses that metaphor. You know, this is not only a personal thing. It's something that we do together. It's a community project. It's something that we allow and submit to together as church community. It's not something that comes naturally to us. You know, church communities are not exempt from all the natural tendencies that have divided humanity for as long as we have been. But we are called in Christ to something different. We are called to peace, to allow the Spirit to gently alight in our lives together and for this fruit to grow. It's a joint project. And we might think particularly about the words that we use together. That's the context of the Colossians passage. We use words that build up and not tear down. And that's us allowing the peace of Christ to rule. He says, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony, and let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Let it have the first place, because that's what we are called to as a church. That's what Christ won for us to enjoy on the cross. And very briefly, the fourth word, thankful. Thankful. You know, thankfulness opens us up to the work of the Spirit because it takes our minds off of ourselves and onto God, who richly blesses us with so many things. As we think about others who again bless us, and we are thankful. As we doggedly list those things that just remind us of the goodness of God. And as we do that, we so often notice the peace of Christ creeping into our hearts and lives. So let us make room for the Spirit to do his work in us and in our churches, that he might grow his fruit, that we might become more like Jesus as he does, and that we would know the peace that passes all understanding, and then allow that peace to flow through our lives to bless others. So peace be with you. Amen.
Oh,
We come to a time of prayer, so let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church, militant here in earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle have taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. Heavenly Father, we pray for the whole church throughout the world, that it may witness faithfully for Christ and the gospel. We pray particularly for those of our brothers and sisters in Christ enduring persecution and discrimination. Give them strength and courage in their suffering and the assurance of your presence. And we beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes and governors, and especially thy servant Elizabeth our Queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed. And grant unto her whole council, and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and impartially minister justice, to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. We pray again for our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, and for our local MP, Robert Courts, and all those who serve in Parliament and local government. Particularly at this time of crisis, give them energy, wisdom, courage, integrity, and good counsel. And give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, rightly and in duly administering thy holy sacraments. We hold up to you Stephen, our diocesan bishop, and Gavin Collins, our new Bishop of Dorchester, as well as Duncan, our vicar, praying for all of them and their families, and also for all who serve in these two parishes. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Merciful Father, we particularly hold up to you those who, at this difficult time, feel isolated or alone, those who feel anxious or fearful, those who are suffering in pain or in loss, those known to us, those known to you alone, Lord. Help them to know your presence and your peace, giving wisdom and skill, we pray, to those who bring comfort and healing and aid to those in need. And in a few moments' silence, let us bring to our merciful Father those whom we know in particular are in a time of need. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. And now, ye that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. We pray the confession together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all those who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your hearts, we lift them up unto the Lord. Let us give thanks to our Lord God. It is meet and right so to do. It is very meet and right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy holy name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high. Amen. And we continue with the prayer of humble access together. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made that by his one oblation of himself, once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and it institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again, hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he gave thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for each of you, preserve your bodies and souls unto everlasting life. We share this bread and this wine in remembrance that Christ died for each of us. So now, in this brief silence, feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. O Lord and Heavenly Father, we, thy humble servants, entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. come to the end of our service. So now may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you this Lenten time and always. Amen.